So hello and welcome to this first episode of China Pow. China Pow is about understanding China and the developments around the world. The topic for our discussion is going to be the challenges before China in the year of the rat. Now, what is the year of the rat? The Chinese zodiac assigns every year to a particular animal. So there is the year of the rabbit, there is a year of the horse. 2020 has been the year of the rat. Now, the year of the rat traditionally brings in a lot of calamities on people. There have been crop failures, there have been earthquakes, and generally bad omens for people. Now, 2020 has really started off on a very bad note for China and the rest of the world. And in spite, we are in the sixth month and large parts of the world are under lockdown, or some parts of the world have partially opened up, but by and large the world is still grappling with the pandemic, with COVID, the pandemic. Now, given this circumstances, China faces really two very big challenges before it. First is its handling of the backlash, and how does it handle its relationship with the US. The second thing is really about its own economic recovery post-COVID. Now, let's take the first issue of the of America, of the US. Now, the deaths due to COVID have been more than 100,000 in the US. Now, this number of fatalities did not even happen during the Vietnam War. So it has far exceeded America's tally of death during in Vietnam in war, and these are peacetime deaths and deaths of civilians. Now, this has led to a lot of anti-China backlash in the US. Also, this is a year when President Trump faces an election. So this has led to a hardening of the stance by the US. So what are the things that immediately threaten China? China is threatened by primarily the US visa regime. So that America is tightening its visa regime, which means that about 2,000 to 3,000 Chinese students who are currently studying in US universities, and some of them are working on very important and crucial research projects, may have their visa cancelled. The US is planning to limit the access of semiconductors, and this may hit large telecom companies like Huawei. There is a plan to delist Chinese companies that are listed on the New York Stock Exchange. The US president has barred investment into of funds into Chinese equities. There are also plans to apply sanctions on Chinese banks. Now, this is with respect to the national security law that will be brought about in Hong Kong. Now, these things really threaten China in a big way. Now, let's move on to what's happening in China internally. The COVID pandemic has meant that large parts of the world have seen a drop in their income because factories have been closed. Many people have been forced to have been laid off. There are places where there have been pay cuts, and China is also not immune to this. Now, the very prosperity of China has been a post 1980 phenomena. I mean, the whole transformation of China, it being the factory of the world, and it has seen a staggering 850 million people brought out of poverty. But a lot more needs to be done because China remains, there are huge income inequalities. And the other fact remains that according to the Chinese government itself, about 350 million people are living under less than $6 a day. So the challenge really for China has been to extricate these people out of poverty. Now with this in mind, the Liang Wei, now Liang Wei is translates into two sessions. The two sessions are basically when the two houses of the Chinese legislature meet. Now this usually happens mid-year. It was postponed, and finally the China's lawmakers met in May. And in May, so of course the government also has been proactive as far as tackling with the economic recovery of COVID. So about the government has allotted about $560 billion to businesses to revive companies. Also of another tranche of about $500 billion has been earmarked as a stimulus. Now the government may increase this package as and when. Usually the Liang Wei or the two sessions is a very important indicator, or it's a very important political event on China's calendar, on China's political calendar, because this is when the Chinese government announces its GDP target for the year. This year, this is the first time in recent memory that no GDP target has been announced. Now the government really doesn't want to pin itself to committing itself to a target, and if it doesn't achieve it, it will again be forced to, the government will have to answer internally to its own forces. Now, given that, the recovery remains a big question mark. So the Chinese premier, Li Keqiang, has highlighted that unemployment remains a very big issue before the Chinese government. He has gone to the extent of saying that many people might even slip back into poverty, and this remains really a very, very big issue, because this has to do with its own internal social discord and social harmony. Now the figures that are being trotted about in media are not very promising. Now in April, the Chinese economy grew at 1.2%. Now the Chinese economy had really been, there was a time that it was growing at 10%, then it dropped to about 6%. But 1.2% is really a huge alarm bell for the economy. Another statistic that has been talked about is its urban unemployment. So in this year, China's urban unemployment is set to touch about 10%. Now this is a huge figure. It is also distressing because this year, in fact this month, a record 9 million youngsters, I repeat, a record 9 million youngsters are going to graduate from China's universities. Now these youngsters, young boys and young girls, will be entering the job market at a time when private sector has stopped hiring. There's a freeze on recruitment. Usually universities in China see a lot of recruitment around the spring festival, that is in Jan and Feb. Usually youngsters have 3-4 offers in hand, and they're very proud of it. They go around telling people that they are in for a big pay package. But this year, because the government ordered a shutdown, the recruitment didn't really happen. So the government has to tide over this issue. The government is looking at creating vacancies in its bureaucracy, in the civil services. So some of the youngsters may be absorbed there. The government has a lot of economic muscle. So you must remember that there are 51,000 state-owned enterprises, which are basically businesses that are controlled or operated by the Chinese government. Now, these 51,000 state-owned enterprises have a collective worth of about $29 trillion, and they employ about 20 million, they have a 20 million labor force. Now, many of these state-owned companies have been directed to increase their hiring, and one of the reasons, and there is a rider to it, that many of the people who will be absorbed will be given a posting in rural areas. Now again, it remains to be seen how effective some youngsters who have really grown up in big cities of China will be effective in a rural setting. So to sum up our discussion again, the US backlash against China has ensured that its growth miracle, its growth impact is affected, its growth, its rise is affected. Now the impact of the visa regime of denying semiconductors to Chinese companies, delisting of Chinese companies, restrictions on investments into Chinese equity, or the sanctions on the China's bank may really impact four things: the trade, technological growth, human capital formation, and finance. Now these are the four things on which, these are really the four ingredients of China's growth. So one of the things that we will be looking at in future episodes is how does China respond to the US? How does China respond to these steps that the US has been mulling or may put into practice? Another thing we'll be looking at is how does China revive its economy post-COVID? And we must remember, China remains the second largest economy in the world. And all eyes will really be on how it revives, because many other economies are dependent on China, like the economy of South Korea, for example. So these really remain the key challenges before China. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for listening in, and do subscribe to China Pow. Thank you.